Born into the illegal liquor business, the young Tim Smith experienced moonshining as a part of everyday life.
I grew up in moonshining. My father was moonshining, and we was always hauling moonshine, making moonshine, picking it up. So growing up at a small age of 5 or 6 years old, I was in moonshining. So moonshine was a medicine, really. You know, so if you had any kind of aches or pains, you know, they put moonshine on it. If you had a sore throat or something, a cold or something like that, then you was allowed to put it in a cup, put some sugar in it, dilute it, and you just do a teaspoon of it. I didn't really know that that was alcohol. It was just moonshine. So it was never introduced to me as a kid to like, here, drink this or nothing like that. So, you know, I'm just a little guy. And I was going with my dad then to make deliveries of moonshine, standing up in the front seat of a pickup truck. When it came time for me to go to school, which was like 5 years old, I was afraid of going to school because I didn't want to leave my dad. I told my dad I didn't want to go to school. And he was like, well, sooner or later you will have to go to school, but you do have a choice. So at 5 years old, I made the decision to skip kindergarten, and I made a deal with my dad. I said, well, I will help you, and you help me learn some things, so when I go to first grade, I won't be like dumb or nothing. So in that first year, I got a little bit more involved in moonshining because my dad would let me count the money. That was an important thing because my dad said that, you know, when you go to first grade, you got to know how to count. My dad had a pencil and a paper, and he would always write it down, and then he would let me write it down. He would say, write this down. My dad had a pencil like this big. It was very short. It occurred in his pocket. And a lot of people would make fun of him, like, why don't you get a full pencil? He said, you don't need all that pencil. You just need that little pencil. Plus, it fit my hand. You know, at 5 or 6 years old, I need a little pencil. I don't need this big pencil this big. It was little. And I'm writing, trying to write what he writes. So I had hands-on writing numbers and calculating how many gallons of moonshine we got. How much did it cost us to make this moonshine? How much is this gonna profit us? When I learned what that net money was, that's a good possibility that some of that could be mine. I did not recognize that we're doing nothing illegal. This is just something that we did, and this made us money, and this gave me, I could go to the store and buy something. Well, as I got a little bit older, 6 or 7 years old, the police came to my house and raided it. They came in and knocked on the door, and they said, we have a search warrant. They took my father outside. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what was gonna happen. I didn't know if they was gonna like take me away. And that's when my mother told me that they're looking for the moonshine, that we have to hide in the moonshine. It was like, okay, we gotta hide some. And as my mom was keeping the law enforcement busy at the front door, I was moving these jugs. And I actually hid it in my room. I put it under my bed, and the bedspread kind of hang down, and it kind of hid there. I was scared to death because I didn't know what was gonna happen. The police came to my room. They didn't tell me to move or nothing. They just kind of like looked around. They opened a few little doors and stuff, and that was it. But my bed was full of moonshine, you know? And it was kind of exciting at the end because after the police went away, he kind of gave me that pat on the back and he says, good job. I did something really, really good. And he gave me $10. I mean, think about this now. I got $10. I used to cut 2 acres of grass to get $2. So at this point on, you've got my interest. I learned the business pretty quick at a young age. I grew up in the woods, learning how to make it, cutting the corn, shelling the corn, grinding the corn, mashing in, all the distilling. My dad's moonshine was just in a mason jar or a gallon jug. And my dad was all about marketing and selling that product. Even going to the old grist mill and grinding up the corn. Well, I'm watching my dad, but you know what's going on? He's marketing moonshine. As he's talking to everyone, we waiting for the corn to be ground. When my dad's working the crowd, he's over there, you know, that's some nice white corn that we putting in there. That could make some nice white liquor, you know. He knew who to talk to, and the people who came and kind of congregated around this area, that corn meal was already sold. because it was going to be made into White Lightning just in a few days. My dad has a little bottle in his pocket. Always has this little bottle of moonshine. And it's a little sample of what he's already made or what he's predicting to make with that corn.
He would like put it in his pocket like this, and he would walk around and have it in his pocket. And as it was politicking, he called it, you know, he was politicking and talking to everyone, he would ask them, you know, you want a little taste, you know, and he would take it out and they would check it, you know, and he would let them check it a little bit, you know, and they'd put it back in his pocket.
He would talk to you about anything. Whatever you want to talk about, he had a game for it. So he would create that discussion and they would all wind up to drinking moonshine at the end, and that would make the sale. And, you know, this was his way of marketing. You know, I learned at an early age how to make that sale.
Armed with the lessons he learned from his father, Tim took on the mantle of the family business.
When I was growing up, my dad had a very tight network, and the people that he worked with had been together for years and years. I didn't have that network that my dad had. So you gotta get other people to help you, and then you all work together.
You've gotta have a partner. This is where I used to work at. I used to work here. It's a mattress manufacturing company, and this is where I first met Tickle at.
We needed to hire people, so we needed carpenters. We hired a lot of people that had been in prison, and a lot of guys who came in that had some bad records. Some of them had killed people before, but they need a job. I mean, they've been in 25, 30 years, they came out. I actually hired this one guy who's never, ever had a job in his life. I think he killed someone when he was a young age, but he later killed another person, and we had to get a replacement. And then here comes Tickle.
I'm Tickle, and I work with Tim.
Had a pretty clean background, just a couple of felonies. He had never killed nobody.
Tickle came in, started working. Next thing I know that, Tickle was a little bit more mechanic inclined than what we knew. And actually, he got the job in maintenance department.
He wasn't a big guy. He wasn't like a big muscle-bound guy as some of the guys that we had hired. But it looked like somebody we could trust.
They're great risks, you know. It's just like any other thing that you're going to do that's, well, not legal.
They used to have this saying about Tickle that you had a body in a car and you called Tickle, he would help you dispose of the body without asking any questions.
Straighten up.
Me and Tickle had good work habits together. We got along, but as we worked together, Tickle did not have the vision that I had and the big picture of moonshining. My business plan was totally different than Tickle's. Tickle's business plan is very short. A few hours and that's about it. Yeah.
We just had a good, successful run. I think we need another taste test.
Oh, need another taste.
The moon is shining on the moonshine.
Yeah, I know. And then when I came to the point that I wanted to go legal, Tickle was positive.
You know, JT's getting ready to, you know, get old enough to go to college. And I need the extra money, but I don't need to get caught. That way I can make moonshine, I can keep on the heritage and make money without worrying about getting arrested.
Well, that'd be real nice, but you know, that costs money.
He was all about it and he wanted to help in any way, but then it became a time where I had to draw the line and say, well, Tickle, from here on, we're gonna do legal stuff.
If we got to, we can hang some tarps up around the thing and run a batch off to make a few extra dollars to finish it if we
legal,
got to.
Legal,
not legal. Not legal. I'm just saying we might have to get some money to finish your building.
Yeah, I know. We can't do that.
And Tickle was more of, I need some money Friday. And then next week, he needs more money. And then we got to do something else illegal to kind of keep him going.
Yeah, I see. You got a load of jugs in there. This ain't low-key riding around in a truck with 800 jugs in the back.
You got to do something to make money.
You'll have to set up something illegal then.
Exactly.
I've been telling you,
that's what's going to have to make the money to pay for this
thing.
I'm
telling you, we ain't going to do that.
But financially, Tickle was destroying himself. And I was looking at bigger and better things that he could not see.
I'm thinking about getting somebody else to help me.
You know what? I'm thinking about getting somebody else to help me do this, too.
And you're going to get somebody else to help you get in jail. I'll come visit you, all right?
So we had to separate.